Welcome to everyone. We've hooked up with our friends in the Great Barrier and down in Gordonton, so we're ready to get underway tonight. We have a study on the subject of providence. Haven't got Nathaniel and Christina. Yes, Esther, well, we're almost there. All right. Well, perhaps so, Gerald, perhaps so. Okay, let's unite our hearts in prayer, shall we? Let's bow in prayer. Our Father, we do delight again to come to you, the one who's revealed yourself to us, especially in the Son of your love, the Lord Jesus Christ. How we thank you tonight that seeing him, we see you. Thank you for the full and rich disclosure of your glory, your compassion, your infinite power that you gave to us in Jesus. Thank you for his indwelling spirit that enables us even tonight to have a living fellowship with you through him. Lord, we come to understand something of the mystery of providence tonight. How we long that as the result of our evening together, we will be able to go away sensing that we know our God better. How much we need clearer, stronger, and more urgent understanding of your glory in the days in which we live. There's so much about us, Father, and so much in us that wants to dull and to shrink and to make bland the glory of God. So help us as we consider your word and these great statements of the Confession of Faith of old. We ask it for your name's sake and glory through Jesus our Saviour. Amen. Well, providence. On your notes, you see a couple of quotations right at the beginning. Firstly, from John Macpherson, who wrote in the 19th century and said this: "The subject of this chapter is really the problem of the present day. God's relation to the world is the most absorbing question under discussion in popular theology. It is here that the relations of science and religion present themselves for examination." Well, that might have been in the 19th century. I'm not sure that today you could say that one of the most absorbing subjects facing people in our universities is the relationship between God and creation. God's banished from the university halls of thinking and is not really in the question. But still, nevertheless, it is a tremendously important question. We've looked in these recent weeks at, firstly, God himself. God is the self-existent triune God. Then we've looked, secondly, and noted that that God has a plan, a purpose, as a thinking, willing, personal being who has a counsel, a decree, a plan, a purpose for all things. Last week we noted how that purpose is worked out, firstly, in his creation of all things out of nothing. And now tonight, the subject of providence picks up and looks at the question of, does God have any continuing interest and activity in the things he's made? Whiter was saying the other night how much he appreciated being able to cast this in the context of a discussion with somebody in Queen Street. So Whiter, this is for you tonight. Let's get back to Queen Street. You've got somebody who's prepared to say, well, I believe there's a God. For some people, it's quite comfortable even believing there's a God out there. Even believing in a God who made everything. But when you get down to the closer relationship of that God with us today, does God have anything to do with the way that I look, the way that I sound, and what I do from day to day? Does God have anything at all to do with what's going on in the nations of the world? Does God have anything to do with that tree out there that's growing? Is there any connection between the Creator and his creation? You see, that's what the subject of providence is about. It is about God's ongoing relationship with the works he has made. So just think of the logic again of the Confession of Faith. It begins by telling us how we can know God and how we can know there is such a being as a God through the world God has made, but especially through the fact that God has intervened into the world, revealed himself, spoken, and scripturated his word, and left us not only with his word, but his spirit to teach us and lead us into an assured truth of his existence. So we know there's a God. We've considered, secondly, what that God is like. And then we're looking now at what he does. He has purposes. Those purposes embrace creation, and now they go on to look at providence. Providence. So yes, we have to say to that person in Queen Street, the God we believe in does interact with his creation. And you see that I've included another quotation here from Wilkinson under the synopsis. Providence is the biblical doctrine of God's activity in the world. The word itself is not found in the Bible in reference to God's operations, but the reality itself is most definitely present in the scriptures. All right then, we've got a number of things to look at in this doctrine of providence tonight. A lot of curly questions, issues that people do ask. Questions people ask, issues they have to grapple with from time to time. Things like, how can God be God and there be sin? Various things like that we'll have to look at. But to begin with, the first section of the confession really looks at the nature of providence. We've already considered a very, very brief definition from Tom Wilkerson, but let's have a look and see how the framers of the confession dealt with this. Now I'm going to have to push these seats forward a bit because I can't see that screen too easily myself. So we'll bring that forward and see how we get on. Right, let's have a look. This again, remember, is not quite the text you've got before you. It's a slightly modernized one, but let's try and follow it as I've got it out here. This first chapter, or this first section on providence, really says this: God, the great creator of all things. So it immediately connects with the fact that this God is creator, the God who made all things. And it carries on. And it uses these words: he upholds, directs, uses, and governs. Those are four pretty critical words. All creatures, actions, and things, from the greatest to the least. Whew! That is typical compressed language of the Confession of Faith. So many, many ideas in this. But let's carry on. He upholds, directs, and uses, and governs that by his most wise and holy providence, according to his infallible foreknowledge and the free and unchangeable counsel of his will, to the praise of his glorious wisdom, power, justice, goodness, and mercy. Well, now, I've sliced this up on this side, the analytical outline, which all the preaching students will be getting very familiar with now. Up here, providence defined, and down here, its basis explained. What it entails, what does providence entail? It involves the great creator of all things upholding, directing, using, and governing. So here we are. What does providence refer to? What does it mean? It refers to the activity of God with his creation, with respect to his creation, and in particular, his upholding, directing, using, and governing. Now, Wayne Grudem, in this textbook, has a chapter on providence, and he puts those words in bold print, upholding, directing, using, and governing, in slightly different terms. He uses three categories. Some theologians only use two. But he uses the words preservation, concurrence, and government. Now, let's have a look and see what these mean up here. God, the great creator of all things, upholds. That's preservation. To preserve all things. And let me just see and mention how Grudem defines this. It's helpful. He says, this whole idea of God upholding all things refers to the fact that God keeps all created things existing and maintains the properties with which he created them. Now, that's quite important. His upholding has these two dimensions to it. Keeps them in existence and keeps them with the properties that he made them with. Now, this idea, so that's preserving. That's what the idea of preserving means. This idea of directing and using, Grudem uses the term concurrence. God works alongside the things he has made and upholds, intimately connected with them. Grudem puts this, it says, God cooperates with created things in every action, directing their distinctive properties to cause them to act as they do. So he's upholding them. He not only preserves them so they exist, and they exist like he made them, but he actually works along with them in their working so that they operate in the way that he's made them to do. So we could even go further than that. In a sense, he does control them and direct them, and that leads to the third aspect of this, namely, government is the term that Grudem uses here. If I can find that for a second. Government, what is that? God's governing indicates that God has a purpose in all that he does in the world, and he providentially governs and directs all things in order that they accomplish his purposes. All right. Now, I don't want you to bog down with that, but it is worthwhile remembering this. God preserves, and God governs, and God works and upholds all things so that they operate as he made them to function. So God is active. Now, I don't know about you, but that's a doctrine that, I'm not always as conscious of as I ought to be. We become so used to get up in the morning, going to the cupboard and getting our Wheat-Bix out or whatever it is we have for breakfast, that we become conditioned very, very quickly to a naturalistic mode of existence. And we just act as though everything's always there or was going to be there, and tomorrow my telephone number's going to stay the same. Because not just because Gerald works with that, but anyway, we just get used to thinking everything's going to be the same. Everything's going to be the same. But why should it be the same? This doctrine of providence teaches us that things are only there and things are only the same. Petrol is only going to make your car work tomorrow because God makes petrol petrol and he sustains petrol as petrol. And its combustible properties are going to be the same tomorrow as today because God's upholding all things. He's personally, wonderfully present and all his creation at all times, willing it to continue in the way that he has made it. That's incredible.
Do you think we as a people have lost that, we've drawn away from that, and the people in the early days have been closer to that?
I think so. Gerald's just asking, do you think we've lost that kind of consciousness? I think we have. And more so in our cities than I think we do in farming countries, and farming in agrarian or rural areas. Farmers who are conscious that they need rain tomorrow or they don't need it raining tomorrow because you cut the hay yesterday are amazingly aware that they are dependent upon their environment and world a lot more oftentimes than we are in our cages, boxes, cars, refrigerators, banks, and so on. So I think that we've become distanced from our dependence upon the world in which we live to a very, very large degree. And so we just think everything's going to carry on as it always has done. Now, can anybody think of a story in the Bible where there was a man who thought everything was going to carry on as always and he was going to enjoy life, but God changed his plan, his mind? What was it?
The rich man who built the barns.
Yeah, the rich man who built the barns. So, what did he say? Luke chapter 12, I believe it is. He said, "Soul, you have many goods stored up for a long time," doesn't he? The parable of the rich fool. Luke chapter 12, 14 and following, verse 18. Then he said, "This is what I'll do. I'll tear down my barns, build bigger ones, and there I'll store my grain and my goods. And I'll say to myself, You have plenty of good things laid up for many years. Take life easy, eat, drink, and be merry. But God said to him, You fool, this very night your life will be demanded from you. Then who will get what you have prepared for yourself? Now, those are words of Jesus, a parable, a story, but the Son of God nevertheless is indicating that God has control over the lifespan of people. And the theologians helpfully go through and they show that this providential government embraces all creatures, actions, and things from the greatest to the least. Now, just before we come back and look at one or two or three more of those things a little bit more closely, let's just take another moment or two as we reflect on this. We've already had a general look at what this doctrine of providence is, and it says, God is involved. God is involved with the world that he has created. Now, if you turn to your notes, you see there that right towards the bottom of page one, this idea of God upholding by a dynamic putting forth of his will and purpose all things that he has made, we've got here, this stands in distinction from the views of, one, deists and rationalists who view God as simply the first of a series of causes and effects. That is, God makes things, gives them various laws, and then sets the whole machine going. So here we go. A.A. Hodge says he is supposed to touch creation only at its commencement, and having given to things a permanent, independent being exterior to themselves, he leaves them to the unmodified exercise of their own faculties. There it is. Clockmaker kind of God, starting things off and letting them all run accordingly. The doctrine of providence is contrary to that. It says God's not at a distance. God's intimately involved. Now, it's also contrary to fatalists who hold that events occur as the result of blind mechanical causation. What have we got? The belief that events just happen without any certain or necessary relationship to God or to any other thing in his control is essentially pagan. There's all the difference in the world between the certainty of mechanical fate and the certainty of divine decree. Mechanical fate is at the very heart meaningless, merciless, and hopeless. I think that's good, isn't it? If you lived in a world which said, what will be, I understand that Islam tends to be terribly fatalistic, does it not, in its general notion. What will be. We are caught up in a big machine or in a world existence where there's no real pattern and there's certainly no control behind things, but things just happen. And Williamson uses these terms. He says, mechanical fate is meaningless. I mean, there's no rhyme or purpose behind events. They just happen. It is merciless. No compassion. No concern for the well-being of people. And in the end, it is also hopeless. It's not going anywhere. Things just happen. A world of fate is not a very comforting one. But on the other hand, the certainty of divinely ordered providence is meaningful, merciful, and hopeful. We believe not in an impersonal, mechanical fate, which is kind of determining the course of the universe. We believe in a personal, loving, gracious, wise Creator God. That makes things meaningful, merciful, and wonderfully hopeful. All right? So there's a couple of things that the doctrine of providence is distinguished from. On the one hand, deism or rationalism, which says God made things and set them off. They've got inherent laws, and everything now operates simply with the laws that it's been set. Fate, which says, well, everything in the world happens just by a colossal action of chance and in a mechanistic way. Thirdly, what have we got? Pantheists. We've talked a little bit about this. Pantheists view the universe as so many manifestations or modes of the one universal substance. We've got here from Hodge again. Some true Christian theologians have taken a view of the relation of God to the world which comes perilously near if it doesn't coincide with this great pantheistic heresy. This view is that God's power is constantly exerted in a continual creating of every individual thing again and again and again, every fraction of duration. The created things have no real being of their own and exist only as thus they are each moment the product of creative energy. Well, worth just pondering that for a little moment. Again, I don't want to get distracted or bogged down. We're just basically looking at these differing views of the relationship of God to creation. Deist, pantheist, fatalist. Now, Hodge there mentions one of the views that even some Christian theologians have held, which has basically said, and tried to explain God's ongoing role with his creation, they said, God's role in creation is, in fact, to keep on creating it and keep on and 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 on creating it. A little bit like a light bulb, perhaps, provided you have 60 fluctuations of something within a second, it looks constant. And they said, what's happening constantly is create, non-create, create, non-create, create, non-create, so that it's happening so fast that there's a constant process of creation going on to exist or to hold everything up into being. Do you think that's what the doctrine of providence is teaching? Don't think so. God's not actively, constantly, every moment, freshly creating atoms. I don't know what would happen to my existence if that was the case, if it suddenly existed, and there would have to be a marvelous process of creating and recreating going on. Okay, what we are better to think of, here's an illustration from Millard Erickson that I read last night. He said that rather than supposing that God is creating everything over again and again and again and again every fraction of a second so that everything holds up in being, he said it's a little bit like one of those electric power tools. Some of you might have electric drills. How many of you have electric drills at home? Yeah, some of you have got electric drills. And some of you pull the trigger in and you've got a little button you can press in and lock it there. Is that right? And it keeps going. He said, well, there's a sense in which God's providence is a bit like that, where God, when he does create, brings into being real, substantial reality. You know, he brings atoms into being that are distinct from his own being and existence. And his providence is upholding what he's made in its existence. It's a bit like having that finger constantly on the trigger of the drill. You're not creating the drill again, but you're... There's a constant process, nevertheless, of upholding it in its action. See, what? Here's the alternative. You know, generally when you're going to drill a hole, you don't just sort of go flicking on and off that switch on the drill, do you, at 60 plus times a second to keep constancy going. No. You turn the thing on and you hold it there so it stays in being. You don't recreate the drill again every moment or so. You just exert a pressure that keeps it operating, what you brought into being operating. And that's what God's providence is like. He does marvelously uphold his creation. How exactly? We don't know for sure, but he does do that. All right, so that's the kind of concept that we've got here. God upholds it. Not only upholds, he directs, uses, and governs all creatures, actions, and things from the greatest to the least. I wonder if we can just take a second or two. Let me ask you and prompt your minds in this. Any of you think of a very, very clear statement in the New Testament in particular which speaks about God or Christ upholding everything he has made? Anybody? Is there a clear passage which speaks about that and leads us to understand that in him all things consist, cohere, will hold together? If somebody asks you, you prove your doctrine that there's an ongoing activity of God to sustain and uphold everything he creates. Anybody? Okay, Colossians chapter 1. All primed up on that for Australia. So, Colossians chapter 1, and what about verse 16? Speaking of the Lord Jesus, Paul writes this, for by him all things were created, this creation, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, All things were created by him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. In him all things hold together. They cohere. They have their continued existence. Hebrews chapter 1 and verse 3 is another verse which says pretty well exactly the same thing. The Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by his powerful word. The Son of God sustaining all things by his powerful word. Just think about that. Every moment we are sustained by the conscious, willing purpose of God. Hadn't just stood back and created, said it's all there, she's all self-existence, just going to go. No. God upholds and preserves and sustains. Jonathan Edwards makes a point of that in that great sermon that he preached, Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God. He pointed out that rebellious sinners, God-defying sinners, are held in existence simply by the mere good pleasure and will and purpose of God, moment by moment. It's the only thing that does it. So, there we are. That's what problems are. What about, let's have a look here, upholding all creatures, actions, things. You can read Psalm 104, some stage or other, where it's very, very clear that God causes the grass to grow, waters to flow, etc. Inanimate creation. Actions of being and people are said to be under God's control. When Pilate and the Jews crucified Jesus, that was according to God's determinate will and purpose, as we've seen. All things, creatures, actions, things, from the greatest to the least, from nations, from rulers like Nebuchadnezzar, to a sparrow that falls from the rooftop, and the number of hairs on her head. All those things are marvelously under the protection, supervision, and upholding, and direction, and government of God. In some incredible way. Any comment on that? Any questions about that? Let's have a look. See if we got this. Boom. All right, no real questions on that then? That's what providence is talking about. God's upholding, directing, governing all things. Now, there's some implications of that we'll look at in a few minutes. But this latter part here just gives its basis. All this is according to his infallible foreknowledge of all things and the free and unchangeable counsel of his will. So he's doing this with utter sovereignty, utter, complete, and perfect knowledge, and all to the praise of his glorious wisdom, power, justice, goodness, and mercy. God is at work, even in our being here tonight. Amazingly, God has been at work in our minds, our hearts, circumstances, lives. He is at work, bringing us here, and ultimately he's doing these things according to his infinite wisdom, counsel, and will for his own glory. Okay, that's what providence talks about. Anybody object to that? You happy enough with that? There is then an ongoing relationship of God with his creation. Okay. Well, that leads now then to this second area that we need to pick up and look at, and that is, okay, you want to say that God is involved in his creation, governing all things, preserving all things. So we're back with Whiter on Queen Street again. And somebody says, well, you say God is in control of everything. How in the world is it then that I make decisions, I make choices? If I get an injury, it's because my daughter Catherine's hit me or done something like that. And you say, you want to say God's in control of all that, but I'll tell you what, I'm dressed like this because I chose to dress like this. So there's a great perplexity comes in the minds of people, is there not, about if God is preserving and if God is governing and if God is making his purposes and decree all come to pass, where do human decisions, where do second causes come in for and so on? Or we look at the, well, there's no rain out there. It's a beautifully sunny evening out here in Auckland tonight. And unusual perhaps, but anyway, next time it rains, and it will. God willing, it will rain. God willing, it will rain. All right.
Not too much.
God willing, it will rain.
Just
to soften the ground. But next time it rains, there can be scientists out there and they can be measuring all the pressure systems. They can be measuring humidities and they can say, look, there's a simple, reasonable, scientific explanation for the rain. There's a scientific explanation where we don't need God to tell us about the rain. The winds blew moisture, the sun evaporated. We can explain it all. Where then does this whole issue of God's presence and God's power and God's control fit in with our world of phenomena, our world of choices, our world of actions and reactions? Well, that's the second main subject that this chapter on providence and the Confession of Faith looks at. And this is what the writers of it say. Although, in relation to the foreknowledge and decree of God, the first cause, all things come to pass unchangeably and with certainty. You see, that's an introductory kind of preface. They're saying, although that happens, yet. So it's wanting to affirm that according to the sovereignty and foreknowledge of God, everything is certain and is going to happen, and it's unchangeable. Nothing can alter that. Although all those things are true, yet, by the same providence, he directs them to come to pass necessarily, freely, or contingently according to the nature of second causes. Okay. Now, what that's saying is this. Although God decreed, dare I say this without being trite and without being trivial. Although God decreed that last Saturday I should have had a haircut, and that decree and infinite foreknowledge of God, who is the first cause of all things, according to his decree, purpose, and plan, that was certain to happen. That was certain according to the decree of God. It was bound to come to pass with certainty and unchangeably. Nothing could change that. Nothing could change that. Yet, by that same providence that upholds all things, he directed that to come to pass necessarily, freely, or contingently. We'll look at that in a minute. According to the nature of second causes. Now, what does that mean? Simply means that, this is going to sound terribly trite and trivial, and in fact, terribly self-centered, so forgive this. I've got started on an illustration, impromptu illustration. It's going to make me look ludicrous. But anyway, what that simply means is this, that conscious that I was needing to go and speak to some professors at Geelong Reformed Theological College on Thursday, having to speak at a church camp, and conscious I was getting slightly scruffy, and that I had to represent the college, and had to be spick and span as I can possibly be, putting all those things together, even though I didn't particularly want to get a haircut, I decided I needed a trim. And I made a decision to get a haircut on Saturday. I made the decision through that process of analysis, logic, and thinking. I made it. That's what second causes are. A range of rational thinking processes in this particular case that led to the conclusion that, yes, I needed a haircut. Now, I made that process of thought and decision. Nobody else did. That's what second causes are. What's another second cause? My wife told me. Oh, well, you see, that's another second cause, yeah. Okay, that's a second cause as well. That's a second cause. Here's another one. Some of you know. We've been out hunting, looking for another vehicle at the moment. According to God's John's snickering down, he's waiting for something. Anyway, according to God's eternal decree and foreknowledge, do you think that there's a vehicle out there that he knows about? You think so? Do you think it's a vehicle? Hey, Tony says yes.
Find it.
All right. And according to that eternal purpose and decree of God, that vehicle is there. But how's it going to come to pass? How's it going to be ours? This is another issue, you see, that comes up. Do we sit there and wait? And since I take the mickey out of Tony occasionally I've got to balance that by bringing in some things he likes to hear, you see. So I'll bring up something in a few moments with regard to that. But you see, God's decree and eternal purpose, he directs to come to pass also according to the nature of second causes. God expects us to go out there and look and investigate and go through a process. We thought we had a vehicle last night that was going to be an absolute winner. Until by the time of driving, I would have got home with a shocker of a headache and took Noel out for a drive again in the middle of the day today just after class. And we both come back feeling claustrophobic, ears ringing and feeling a bit sickish. Well, that kind of thing feeds Sam there. Sam still thinks I'm the biggest wimp under the sun. And he's about right. But anyway, he's about right. Sorry, Sam. Because Sam put a lot of hard work into getting that vehicle, and he thought it was a good one, you see. But anyway, what I'm illustrating is there's a process of second causes that lead behind not that particular vehicle. Now, you say, where in the world does all this fit in? God's providence embraces second causes. His foreknowledge and his sovereignty and his design and his plan are so infinitely all-encompassing, and his presence in and with guiding, directing, and disposing mind and heart and circumstance are such that his eternal plan is worked out through the processes of second causes. Things happen. You have a property. You have it because you save, you look, you find, you buy. And all of that is connected with God's eternal purpose and providence. Now, there's no question that one of the ways and areas in which we as Reformed people can fall into problems is to think that God's decree, which makes things certain, absolutely certain and unchangeable, means we can't do anything. Because if we do anything, we will mess it up. Now, that's a mistake. That's a failure to see that God works out his plans and purposes through the responsible action and reaction of second causes. God determined that I should have a wife. He also, in his providence, ordered, and the whole sequence of events, that I should be invited to teach or to speak and to be a leader at an ISEF camp in Lumsden Hills in 1972. Also, quite remarkably, in this whole intricate design of things, he ordered that one of the assistant cooks should be sick and that Nola should be drawn into the fray just at the very last day, just the day before the whole camp was due to begin. A sick cook, my future wife gets, and we meet at this camp. Just, was, anyway.
Is that a booze away from me now?
All right. The point I'm trying to make is that here we are, God's behind this whole design, but I was down there, I was speaking, I was talking, and Nola was cooking. And yeah, God was at work in and through and behind all these things most remarkably, but it takes place in the context of us fulfilling our responsible actions. And so often we wait for God to dish things up to us, passively waiting for him to do it. That's not the way his providence is bigger than that. His plan, his decree, embraces all of the secondary causes. So much so, we can't expect to discover and know and enjoy his will and blessing without fulfilling our responsibility. And we need not be afraid at any point in time if we are responsibly doing and acting according to God's will that we're going to somehow confuse his providence. No, that's the way he's determined to work out his plan and purpose. We've got to preach, got to witness, got to look for a wife, got to look for a husband, or if it's appropriate, whatever. But we've got to do those things. And many of us today are really, again, it's in the providence and purpose of God, but many of us are being wrongly hindered by that. Let me just see if I can get this bit here. There's a little section here, Tony, if I can just get it just for you. This is for you, Tony, just to say how much I appreciate this. But I won't be able to find it now since I've been cheeky. But we'll see. Government. So I'll just have to give you Grudem to read, won't I? Anyway, here we are. No, you've done that once. We are still responsible for our actions. Yeah, here we are. In conclusion, we must act. What he's saying is, providence, the doctrine of providence, is no excuse for inactivity. And Grudem writes this, the doctrine of providence in no way encourages us to sit back in idleness to await the outcome of certain events. Of course, God may impress on us the need to wait on him before we act, or to trust in him rather than our own abilities. That's fine. That is certainly not wrong. But simply to say that we are trusting in God instead of acting responsibly is sheer laziness and a distortion of the doctrine of providence. God's given us our duty and he calls us to do our duty, and we have the absolute freedom to know. His foreknowledge and sovereignty and decree are so vast and big and all-embracing that they include all the second causes, all the responsible actions. So we can always go forth doing our responsibility, confident that we're not getting it in the road of God's working. All right? One thing that is just worth noting here in this, by the same providence he directs to come to pass either necessarily, freely, or contingently, according to the nature of second causes. Those three words are worth just noting for a second. Some things in the providence of God come to pass necessarily. Let me just see. If I don't go out and plant cabbages in the garden, I'm not going to get any cabbages to eat. And that's because of a cause and effect which occurs necessarily in nature. You plant water, fertilize the sun, keep the bugs away, and things will grow because there's a necessary relationship in the way God's created. So certain things will happen. If I put my hand on a blazing hot fire, they're going to burn. There's a necessary connection between cause and effect in some things. Now, other things come to pass not so much because it's in the very nature of things to happen, but because of free choices. God's providence and events come to pass because people choose to do things. You think of the marvelous way in which Joseph and Mary ended up down in Bethlehem. They ended up in Bethlehem, what? Was there some innate, necessary, biological cause that of necessity made them go down there? No. How did they end up down in Bethlehem? They went down there because Augustus Caesar, in his wisdom, made a choice. Augustus Caesar chose that there should be a decree, or passed a decree, that there should be taxation in Judea, and everybody had to go to their homes. There's a choice, was a factor. It was the free choice sometimes is the thing that leads to God's purposes working out. There are other occasions when things happen contingently, or that is probably what we would say almost by chance. In the proof text that the Confession of Faith gives, it alludes to that soldier who drew his bow at random and shot it, remember? Pierced a link in the gap in the armor of Ahab and killed him. He said, well, sometimes God causes things to come to pass what seems to be almost by chance events to us. Seem to be chance. They're not the result of the necessity of some natural law of cause and effect. It's not by some human choice, but it's almost just by some accident or coincidence. But God's got it all planned out, all in his purpose, to embrace all those things. All right. Now, can we pause again just for a minute and just check and see if you're following that? First section says, God upholds, directs, governs, works with, and embraces all things that happen with all his creatures. He's in them, governing, directing, upholding. The second section is say that he's doing that in a way that's perfectly in harmony with second causes. Human choice, human activity. He works in and through the weather patterns, all those things. They're all part of his creation. He works through those things and in those things. Okay? So second causes are established and not negated by God's providence. Happy? Having said that, there is another little section in the confession which says this, God, in his ordinary providence, makes use of means, yet he is free to work without, above, and against them according to his pleasure. Now this is basically recognizing that there will be times when we witness and God acts in ways which are apart from his ordinary means of operating, namely in miracles. Okay, miracles are instances of God operating without, above, or against the means he has created. What this section is wanting to say is that God can never ever be bottled up and constrained by the laws that he establishes in his creation. He does make his wonderful world to operate and function through all this intricate harmony of second causes. You eat and you grow. You marry, have relationships, sexual relationships, and you have children. All part of God's wonderful design. And yet there are times, as in the conception of Jesus, where the Lord can work apart from.